three of you all sitting down, and we can take questions now or discussion points. Yes. I know, well, this gentleman's gone as well, because he had a question earlier on.
Here's a question for Lynn.
Thank you very much for that very interesting presentation. My name is Margaret Mugugi from Kenya. I would like you to clarify on the types of conflict you are addressing here, because in the northern Kenya, you know, there are conflict between communities, different communities, equally, there is also conflict that are happening or that have been happening between the communities there and also the ranchers, people who own ranches in that area. So I would like you to clarify which conflicts are you addressing exactly, or are you addressing all of them? Thank you.
Yes, I would say that the Alberta Conservation Council is addressing multiple types of conflicts, because their role is both peace building and to be conservationists. So if they see harm come to wildlife, they're addressing a conservation conflict issue. But if there's issues between communities, they're addressing those issues. Now, I'm not aware, when you talk about ranchers, are you talking about the pastoralist herders?
Thank you. In northern Kenya, there are certain private conservancies.
Okay.
And we have communities recently in northern Kenya have been driving their livestock into the private ranches illegally.
Right.
And then the conflict has arisen between these people because they conserve wildlife as well as maybe keep livestock in those private ranches and they hinder a lot. But again, communities where there is no grass on their side or on their land, they want to drive their livestock in. Some of them believe that that is their land, so there's a big conflict between them as well.
Yeah, I mean, this is a really focused effort with the Grevy's Zebra Center. So I would say Grevy's is probably not addressing those specific issues unless they're being impacted in the areas where Grevy's are.
Thank you. Mine is to So just from where she came to the help of Shivilia on about where the elephants came from. There's a theory, like through your research, I mean, do you have any such theory that in 1994, there was a great outbreak of cattle lung disease. And after that outbreak, so all cattle were killed in the Delta area. And after that, 30% people were given option of being compensated their cattle or replaced with other cattle or cash. Or 70% cash, 30% cattle. There were some various options. Most of those who opted for cash and cattle lost the cattle side, because when this cat came from other regions, they were not acquainted to the habitat. There were some from other plants that when they ate, they died. And now, during that period, when there was no cattle or less, the elephants came. Now, there's a theory that's coming from the opposition parties, that when government, particularly the BDF, were instructed to go block the areas where the buffalo fence was cut, had fallen off or cut off, they refused. They said their duty is not wildlife, but I mean, so throughout your study, because I see it was intense, and I interviewed 1,200 farmers in that area. Most of them, they felt the impact of because everybody was dependent on agriculture, livestock. So I want you to, from your studies, you never had this theory that it was a deliberate move. Because where government saw cows, they wanted to see buffalo instead.
Thank you for that question. I think I probably have to be very careful how I answer a question like that. I don't know if that was the case, and I wouldn't like to say whether it was or not. There's a number of theories as to why the elephant population started to increase after 1995. One is the fact that the lung disease wiped out the cattle, which then meant that there wasn't the presence of people and cattle up in the drylands, and then it allowed elephants to kind of come in, is one theory. Also, the fence between Botswana and Namibia, that was erected around 1995-96. And again, some people theorize that actually that's prevented elephants from leaving the area, and therefore the population has started to just increase, and they haven't left the panhandle. But our research shows that it's increasing rapidly, so elephants are coming into the area from other places. But we think it's more likely that they're coming in from the Okavango side. There doesn't seem to be so much movement across the Namibia border fence, but that's one of the motivations for putting on so many collars. And we're collaborating with WWF Namibia. They put on collars on their side, in the Bobata section in Zambezi. And so we're at the stages where we're then looking at what's trying to predict what's happening.
In your opinion, because you stated that when you are given the background for the study, you said there were 16,000 people and 18,000 elephants. Is that healthy? In your
yeah, that's a good question. I think it's clear if you look at what situations throughout the world where there's people and elephants, where conflict seems to become really, really intense, what happens then is that you've got a higher population of people. With such a high population of elephants, they're still, you know, during the rains, they still move away from where the people are living and they go off. They still try to avoid where there's people as much as possible, apart from maybe when they go into farmers' fields and things. So right now, I wouldn't say that it's not healthy. I think that we have a chance in that area. There's still land, people still have space, and there is still space for elephants. So right now, I think it's okay. What happens in the future, yeah, we'll have to see.
My name is Aman Degye from Tanzania. It happened that I had a discussion with a colleague of mine who is a researcher on an elephant, and he actually was researching on operating by elephants. And what he said that in his observation that when elephant go for operating, actually it's not the whole family is going to operating, but he observed that most of the time were the bulls and not the actual family. And they use specific pathway to work with the farms. So my question is, do you observe the same pattern in your research? That they are specifically an elephant that are going for cooperating in with the family. That's one. The second, that in the presentation, you show that the number of pathways that elephants are using and with frequency, different rate of frequency of use. And one of the pathways was in late car, and you say that was the most frequently used pathway. Why? What's the reason behind? Is it closest to the farms, or is it the natural historical pathway?
Okay, no, thanks. So to answer your first question, the patterns of raiding and the types of elephants that are doing the crop raiding in the area, it varies, actually, throughout that area. There are some areas where there are habitual raiders, and they're predominantly males doing that. But there's also a lot of cases where there's female herds going in, and then they can have more impact because a whole herd going through. So it varies throughout the study. It's not like a general pattern, and it varies throughout the different years as well. And in terms of pathways, that main pathway, the reason we think that there's it's such a big pathway is because it's pretty much leading from a whole network of waterfill, rainfill pans up in the dry land, because there's these kind of old fossilized riverbeds that then hold water for longer. And so there's these networks going up to the north of that, and it really is the most direct route coming from there down to good water sources in the delta. So we think that that's why that's such a big pathway. So it's an old migratory path. You know, it's been there for many, many years.
Hello, my name is Tilly. I'm in Tim and Cheetah Conservation Fund. I come from Zimbabwe, close to the Wellbeing National Park. We live there. Highest population of elephants, I think. What most people see is a conflict between people and elephants. For me, where I come from, it's not really a conflict. It's more of like an interaction. There are times when elephants they move to the places where people live. Well, most of the time, yeah. So when they come to the farm, what we do in Zim is they dig walls, you see, around the farm. Not really like a one hole, but it's like a huge tunnel.
Trench.
Yeah, like a trench. What we grew up knowing is that elephants don't jump as big as they are. So when you dig a trench around the farm, you see, they don't cross into the field. So like, so for us, we're not really afraid of them. There's people saying that if you see a lot of elephants, you run away or sleep and stuff. To us, elephants were like a cattle. You just see them and then you walk around. They don't really like attack you from nowhere like carnivores would do. Elephants are almost friendly animals. To us, I don't know how they deal with them in the Delta region, but from my own perspective is, I think the coexistence is actually easier if you look at how people used to live with the elephants earlier, and look at how they used to manage living with them, and not just treat them like dangerous animals, like say that people should move away or we should plan on changing the management plans of that area, like the land use system. I think we should also look at the ways which people used to live, those with higher elephant populations, how they interact with them, instead of looking at it like a conflict way. Because to us, elephants are not really scary. We live with them easily.